Hold on to me as we go, as we roll down this unfamiliar road. And although this wave is stringing us along, just know you're not alone, 'cause I'm gonna make this place your home. Settle down.
John chapter 15, verses 12 through 17. That's the Gospel of John, chapter 15, verse 12 through 17. And then if you could put a bookmark in Galatians 4, verses 4 through 7. So that first one again was Gospel of John 15, verse 12 through 17. And the second one was Galatians 4, verse 4 through 7. As you're turning there, the topic that we're going to kind of be talking about, I'm really, really excited about it. My wife kind of walked in when I was kind of going through it and praying last night. Man, I was jazzercised. I'm really excited about what God has kind of put on my heart this morning, which is partnering with God through prayer. Partnering with God through prayer, right? And so we're going to take a look at that, but let's pray and then we'll kind of dive in. Lord God, I thank you for this morning. I thank you for this body of believers. Even as we were praying this morning, just the collection of people that you've brought, I'm so thankful to be a part of this community, such a loving community, and a community that comes after you and wants more of you, doesn't want to settle for the routine and the mundane, but wants to press in deeper into you. So Holy Spirit, we just ask that you would come here this morning, that you would meet with us, that we would hear your voice. Lord, that we would be transformed by you, that we wouldn't leave the same way that we came in. God, this wouldn't just be routine, what we do on Sunday morning, God, but we would truly be touched by you. Let's just take a moment and just kind of position our hearts, position ourselves to be receptive to what it is God wants to share. Maybe it'll be something different for you than for someone else. Maybe it'll be something specific that God highlights. But whatever it is, let's just position ourselves right now to receive. Lord, I thank you. I thank you that you allow us to come into your presence, that you allow us to have communion with you. Lord, I pray as we position ourselves, we open ourselves up to you, God, you would be faithful to meet us here this morning. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So with prayer, I think if we were all to sit down, we were to move all the chairs around and create kind of a circle group and sit down and have a discussion about prayer. I think if we put it out there, how important is prayer? We would have a very wide consensus, if not unanimous, that prayer is extremely important, that we need to pray. It's extremely important, right? But I think, and this is not a condemnation statement, but I think if we were to look into ourselves and look into ourselves and evaluate how much we actually practice what we say we believe, I think that would be hard for some of us, myself included, right? We would look at what we know the importance of prayer is, right? We would look at it and say, okay, we need to pray. That's when things happen. That's when things change. But then if we were to put that as a foil up against our own lives, we would look at that and say, am I praying like I really believe that, though? And again, this is not to condemn you. This is I'm sitting in the seats just with you. I'm preaching to myself here. But I think if we look at that, we'll see there's a little bit of a discrepancy between what we say we believe and what we actually live out. And I think there's many reasons for that. I'm not going to go into all of them. We're very busy and we get distracted with different stuff. But what I felt like God was laying on my heart is sometimes our perspective of what prayer is or how we're supposed to use prayer sometimes can get off just a smidge, just one degree, just a little bit. And because of that, it changes the way that we view prayer. I feel like sometimes we approach God and we approach prayer almost in this way in which we're almost asking for permission or asking God if it's okay that we pray for this thing. Now, I understand that heart position, right? So I come and pray sometimes like that as well. The heart position of that is the reverence towards God, right? We understand who God is. God is almighty, all-powerful, all-knowing, and we're just people, right? So we're coming in that heart of reverence, and we don't want to contradict the will of God. But sometimes I think we come with this passive, like, okay, God, if it's your will, have this happen. But I don't know. Or God, if it's your will, is it okay? And we're kind of coming almost with this passive heart. Again, I'm hoping and I'm believing that most of the time it's coming out of reverence. But I think we got to be careful, because if we look at the New Testament and the invitation to prayer that Jesus gives us and that's laid out in the New Testament, there's actually a different approach. There's the reverence, but there's also this coming before the throne of grace with boldness, right? There's Jesus talking to blind Bartimaeus, and he's like, "What do you need? What do you need? Specifically, what do you need?" And coming with something, coming boldly before the throne of grace. Right? And so the beauty and the difficulty of a New Testament believer is trying to figure out how to, in a healthy tension, balance this reverence that we have for God and his plan, but also coming with this boldness. And so what I want to do is kind of look through a couple scriptures that show in the New Testament this invitation that Jesus gives to prayer. And then we'll kind of go from there. So the Gospel of John, chapter 15, verses 12 through 17. If you're not there yet, I can't afford to give you any more time. In verse 12, it says, "This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, than to lay down one's life for his friend. You are my friends if you do whatever I command you. No longer do I call you servants, for a servant does not know what his master is doing. But I have called you friends. For all things that I have heard from my Father, I have made known to you." So we see Jesus making this distinction, right? This distinction. It's this invitation. See, we have to realize sometimes we remember, but sometimes we're not quite sure of just the profound nature of what Jesus was doing here. In the Old Testament, God revealed himself through his name and through different characteristics, but all of that was packaged under this authoritative God, and the relationship then that man had to take with God was as servant, right? We had to do servant. God would say for us to do something, we would do it. And Jesus now comes, and you wonder why they wanted to kill him. You wonder why he was so hated among his people, because he's coming and saying to the Almighty God, the one that we can't even utter their very name of, I'm now saying he calls you friend. See, we in the New Testament, we see this all the time. We hear these scriptures, we see it, and I sometimes think that maybe we glaze over this or we get used to it, but this is profound, that the God of the universe calls us friend. And the distinction that Jesus makes between servant and friend is extremely powerful. He says the servant doesn't understand what the master's doing. It's almost like a militaristic relationship, right? That God's the general and we're the private, and he assigns us to go out, and we don't see the big battle plan. We don't see what's going on. We're just there to obey orders. But he says, as a friend, I'm inviting you into this circle, into this circle of understanding, into this circle of relationship where you can start to get to know me. You can start to get to know me. You can see my character. You can start to understand who I am. It's a revolutionary boundary to cross over, but he invites us into this circle as a friend. Get to know you, right? And in that last verse there, it says, "For all things that I have made or that I have heard from my Father, I have made known to you." So how do we get to know God? through Jesus. We can look at, first of all, we can look at Scripture. We can see the character of God revealed in Scripture, and we can see that, right? But this specific Scripture shows that it's Jesus saying, look, all that spoken about the Father. So we can look at Jesus' life. We can look at his prayer life. We can look at his words, the red words in your Bible. We can look at that and start to understand the character of God. It's like when you're on a date with somebody or you're dating somebody, right? You can sit down and you can talk to them and you start to get to know them. When I was dating my wife, I could see, okay, this is what she values. She's a creative person. She loves beautiful things and she loves elegance and this type of stuff. I can see, okay, this is the thing that she's passionate about. So I'm not surprised when we buy a house and she wants to make the thing beautiful and elegant and not very manly, right? I can do that and it's okay. Where's Tyler? Tyler said he was going to laugh at my jokes today. He's leaving me hanging. Anyway, but I can see that that is who she is, right? So through the Bible, through reading the Bible, we can start understanding the nature and the character of God. Looking at the life of Jesus, we can do that. Looking at what he spoke. Right, so he invites us into the all-powerful God, invites us into this relationship where we can start to get to know him on a personal level, see his character, see his the things that he values. But then, of course, we know that Scripture doesn't stop there, right? That there, he invites us into this inner circle of friends, but then he goes one step further, and he invites us into the relationship as a son. Right? Galatians 4, if you want to turn there. Galatians 4, verse 4 says, but when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, that we might receive the adoption as sons. And because you are sons, God has sent forth the spirit of his son into your hearts, crying out, Abba, Father. Say, Abba, Father. Therefore, you are no longer a slave, but a son. And of a son, than an heir of God through Christ. Say, heir of God through Christ. Does anyone know what Abba Father means? Daddy. Abba Father carries with it a translation that we don't really have, which is why they actually don't even translate it, that word Abba. It's this intimate, right? When you see, you know, I've got little my little niece, Alexa, right? And Lydia, right? And when you see these little ones just cry out, Daddy, Mommy, it's this intimate cry out. It's this intimate call out. And that's what's inside this word Abba. And so we see that God is inviting us into this intimate relationship with him, not just as servants, not just as friends, but now into sons. And it's this intimate of Abba Father, right? And with that, because our Father, because our Abba Daddy is King of the kingdom, God of the universe, that now carries with it not just that relationship and that intimacy, but it carries with it a level of responsibility because we are now an heir. An heir to what? An heir to the kingdom of God. We know that Jesus brought the kingdom, right? In Scripture it says the kingdom of God has come nigh unto you. That means that if you translate out another way of saying that, it's like within arm's reach. It's accessible to you now. And we know that that kingdom is accessible by faith. So we need to believe for things, and through that belief, we have faith, and we pull that into, and we bring that here to the world. We see that in the Lord's Prayer. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, right? Through faith, through belief, we're able to pull into the promises of Scripture, like salvation, like freedom, like redemption, like all these promises that we see. We're able to pull those things or access those things through faith and apply them here today. And so heirs is the kingdom. That's our role, that we carry the kingdom and we're advancing the kingdom. See, do we see that this is who we are? See, when you look at the world around you, you see the news stations, you see the consistent conversations as I talk to believers, and you know what? And I understand why, but you know what you hear all the time is that Christianity is under attack. And we see that, of course, the laws are changing. I understand why people are saying that, but it's this notion that we're on defense or something. Do you realize that the scriptural basis, the scriptural identity of who you are is not that you're on defense, you're advancing. Right, Scripture says that the kingdom of God is advancing and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it, right? That we are on the offense. Why? Because we have been brought into an intimate relationship with the God of the universe. And he has a purpose and he has a plan. And he wants us to partner with him to make that kingdom come to pass. The Jews missed Jesus in part because they believed he was bringing a natural kingdom, like Rome, to kick out Rome and establish the kingdom of Israel. What they missed was that Jesus brought the Spirit of God in, or brought the kingdom of God in the Spirit, and then made accessible to us through faith to access that, and then to move with that and advance that kingdom. Because the kingdom of God is not here or there. Where is it? It's within us. So this is who we are. When we come and we gather, when we call ourselves Christians, we are heirs to the God of the universe. We are heirs to the kingdom of God. We are sons. We are friends of God. When you talk about this, or when you put it in this mindset, you put it in this phrasing, from experience, a lot of times the biggest issue that people have with it, the biggest opposition that people have with this is, well, I don't know what the will of God is. So you're telling me to come with boldness and to pray for these things. I don't know what the will of God is. And it's a valid concern. We don't want to be disobeying God. We don't want to be walking outside the will of God, right? Right? Okay, good. We don't want to be doing that, but the beauty is that God has made a way for us to come and get to know him, to be friends with him, to be a son and daughter of his, right? So we get this invitation, and he specifically addresses this specific issue in Romans chapter 12, verse 2. That's Romans chapter 12, verse 2. Romans chapter 12, verse 2. Hopefully y'all are turning. Pfft, all right. Man, I don't know. Energy is low this morning, and I'm trying to get some life in this place. Romans chapter 2, 12, verse 2. I'm going to take it as you guys are just like, wow, this guy's really smart. God's really using this guy. We're going to listen. That's what I'm going to take this as. Ooh, man, I'm flopping here. This is rough. I love it. You guys are awesome. Romans chapter 12, verse 2. Says, do not, oh, actually, before I do this, anyone who's heard me preach is probably sick of hearing this because I talk about this scripture all the time. Because again, like I said, I have a teacher background. I love to see change. I like to see growth. I like to see improvement. I like to see stuff happen, right? And so I believe that there's extremely powerful key to unlock growth and to unlock transformation right here in Romans chapter 12, verse 2. And so I'm going to bring it up again. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. The first portion of that, right, is don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed, right? Scripture 2,000 years ago says if you want to change behavior, if you want to see people's lives change, that you can't just try to change behavior. The way you change behavior is actually for you to go all the way back to the beginning and change the mind, change the mindset, change your thoughts. I don't know if you've seen the studies. I talk about it all the time when I bring up this topic, but sociologists have come out and they've done studies now that, again, that same principle. If you want to change behavior, you cannot change behavior on a behavior level. They found that thoughts determine beliefs and beliefs determine actions. Thoughts determine beliefs and beliefs determine actions. So if you want to change actions, you don't try to change actions. You don't try even to change beliefs. You go all the way back and you change the thoughts. So scientists are now proving what Scripture's been saying for 2,000 years. So the beauty here is that it says, okay, you're going to do this through not being conformed to the world, but being transformed. How you transform, right? Through the Holy Spirit, right? As you meditate on his word, as you get to know him, you start to see this, right? And so he now has this transformation, or he starts this transformation in you, and so you start seeing things the way he sees things, and hearing things the way he sees, and feeling about things the way he feels about these things. And this transformation takes place, and we see this through the sanctification process. This is our lives. It's this growth process. We're being transformed more into the image of Christ so that we can then walk that out. But the second half of that verse says this, right? It says, in the midst, oh, I'm sorry, that's the wrong scripture. It says that by testing, you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. So how do you discern the will of God? He says through testing, right? Through testing. That word testing is not like taking a test. It's like revealing. By revealing, right? As you go through an experience and you respond a certain way, it reveals the way that you are or the place that you're at. So basically what it's saying is through trial and error. Through trial and error. So as you're trying to hear from God, right? It's talking about transforming your mind. So as you're being transformed, you're learning to hear God and not the world anymore, and you're walking that out, right? But you do that through testing. It's a process. You're not going to do it perfect the first time you try or the fifth time you try, right? But you're getting progressively better at it, step by step by step by step. You're testing it out, right? And it shows, it says, what is the will of God, what is good and perfect and perfect, acceptable, you know, that list, right? So you see that as we get to see the character of God, we're in our word. We're praying. We see how God responds to certain things. We can see, okay, God is love. So then when we're in a situation, right, and we're trying to decide, okay, should I do this or not, we can see, okay, is the motivation love? Is what I'm doing love? If it's not, then we can evaluate and say, okay, that's not God, right? So we do, and then as, obviously, that's a very general term, but now we start getting more specific, more specific, more specific. You see it with another general example, if you're looking for a job, right? You can look at a job on some level, on some surface. You know, if you're deciding between being an accountant and, a stripper, right? You can look at it and say, okay, well, that doesn't fit inside the nature of God. So I'm not going to go that direction, but I can do that through accounting, right? So that's the easy. But what happens when you're an accountant and you're trying to decide between two accounting jobs? That gets a little bit more difficult, right? But here's what's really cool, is do you know that there's two words in the New Testament used to describe the Word of God? There's logos and rhema. Does anyone know what logos means? The written Word of God. Anyone know what rhema means? What was that? The revelatory, right? It's that intimate, it's that on-the-spot type of language, right? So we see the Word of God, logos, in the written Word of God, right? But then we also can hear from God on specific things. That's what David was hearing, okay, I'm going to bring two people out front there. That was the rhema Word of God. It was that prophetic, it's that fuel for the prophetic to operate, right? So he heard that, so he went out and did that and then talked to those two individuals, right? That's the rhema, right? So the beauty of it is that we get to know God first through Scripture, and we get that basis, we get that framework, but then in difficult situations where you're not quite sure and Scripture isn't able to show you what accounting job to take, we can start praying and we start hearing the voice of God. And we learn how to discern what is God and what is not God through practice, through trial and error. So if you're struggling with that, and maybe you're in a situation and you've been praying, you're like, well, I can't hear the Word of God. Well, it could be for several reasons, but one of them might be that you haven't been asking long enough. It's like standing there after 3 dates and we're like, well, I'm not sure if I'm supposed to marry this person or not. Keep going out with them and find out. Like, you're cutting the journey short, right? And so it's the same principle. If you haven't heard from God, I don't know what God's will is with this thing. Okay, well, keep praying. Maybe you haven't heard it yet. Maybe you're at the beginning and you have trouble sometimes hearing from God. Maybe it just looks like you stepping out in the little things. I'm not saying over-spiritualize your life, but if you want to start hearing God more, it says test it, practice it. So do it in the little stuff before you show up in a massive decision where you need to hear from God. It'd probably be good if you asked or learned how to hear from God before that. So the little things in your life. Maybe you're just sitting there or bored, or maybe you have a little decision to make. And just take that moment, just step back and say, okay, God, I want to hear your voice better. What one should I do? And practice this skill. See, God has made a way. If he's calling you an heir and he's giving you the responsibility of an heir to walk that out, he has made a way for you to walk out his plan. But the beauty of it is that he does it through relationship. So when we talk about prayer, I promise you, we're getting back to that. When we talk about prayer, a prayer life gets you, a prayer life helps you grow in that relationship with God to become better friends and to become deeper in love and to understand what it is as a son and to learn those promises. Prayer helps you with that connection. It's relational. It's relational. And prayer helps you connect with that. I don't know how many of you have thought about this before, but as a teacher, that being the background, we're taught, you know, you need to communicate things in the way that is the simplest as possible, right? Teach something in the most efficient way possible so that the people can understand. Not so you can talk, but find a way to connect with them where you can get it and convey it to them where it's easy for them to receive, right? And so a few years ago, I was looking at Scripture, and I see Jesus teaching, right? And we all know Jesus is the best teacher. Jesus is a teacher, right? Have you ever looked at how Jesus teaches? Like, really looked at it? If somebody asks a question, what does he do? He asks another question. Or he gives an answer that leaves you with more questions than you had coming to him, right? And I'm looking at, I'm struggling with this, right? If you want to advance the kingdom, if you want people to come to the knowledge of you, I'm thinking, wouldn't it make sense to make it as obvious and as simple as possible? Right? And so I'm wrestling with this. I'm trying to figure this out, right? And what's really cool is I feel like God showed me this, that his primary goal in teaching us is not for us to understand. His primary goal is relationship. As he's teaching you something, his primary goal is not necessarily for you to understand it, though that is a secondary goal. His goal through teaching you is for you to lean on him and come to him. And let's go through this journey of discovery together. And through that process, as we get from the question to the answer, I've now got to know my Lord and Savior even better. I've got to know my God even better now. That his purpose through these journeys, right, is to draw closer to us. So this kind of shifts the perspective of those things we've been praying for a while. Because the goal is relationship. We'll get to the answer. We'll get to point B. But I want to go through this with you. Many of you know Luca, little Luca. Jamie and Luca have been living with us at our home, right? And we had the fire at the house a while ago now, right? But we just got back into the house. And when we got back into the house, if you leave your plumbing and don't use your plumbing for a while, what can happen is fruit flies can start burrowing in there, nesting in there, and they lay eggs, and they love, like, drains that aren't being used. And if you're not running water through them constantly, they kind of come in there. So we had an issue with fruit flies in our sinks, right? So a few weeks ago, I was going downstairs to try to get rid of these fruit flies, right? And you find out that you need apple cider vinegar. You pour it in a cup. You put some saran wrap on top, rubber band it, poke some holes in it. The vinegar draws them in, and then they get trapped in there, right? Pretty simple trap, right? So I'm walking downstairs this one evening, right, and I'm going to do this, and I look over as I'm going downstairs, I see Luca on the couch, and the thought comes to me, is like, man, I haven't really hung out with Luca, you know, in a while. So I got to do this thing, but I'm going to have him come over and do this with me, right? So I brought him over, I got the stool so he could get up on the counter, and so he gets the apple cider vinegar. Anyone who's a parent knows what I'm talking about, right? You get the apple cider vinegar, you're pouring it into the cup, I'm telling him when to stop, and I give him the plastic, he puts the plastic on, puts the rubber band on, starts poking holes, poke too many holes in one of them, but we fix that problem, right? And so he gets these cups ready and all that, right? And so if I'm looking at this story, not only am I teaching him one of life's greatest lessons, but, that's a joke, but, and you're allowed to laugh. Man, this is rough, man. I gotta stop doing jokes. It's just not the crowd to do this. But not only, well, he learns how to do that, which wasn't really what I was trying to do, but he learned how to do it, but I was able to spend time with him through that, right? Any parent knows the most efficient way to get something done is not to involve a five-year-old to get it done, right? But the primary goal of that was not to get the job done. It was a secondary goal. The primary goal was to spend time with Luca. And here's the beautiful unintended consequence that happened, is that I didn't know that the downstairs bathroom also had an issue with it. This downstairs bathroom is the bathroom that they use. And so as we're putting it, he's going to each bathroom, he's putting the cups on there. He tells me, hey, we've got fruit flies in our sink as well. We need it there. See, not only did he learn how to do it, but he understood the heart. He understood the why behind it so that he, apart from me, was able to see a situation in need and was like, oh yeah, we need to do this here too. He got it. He grasped what I was trying to do, which was get rid of the fruit flies. Beautiful analogy. I'm trying to get rid of the fruit flies. Hey, we got laughter. we're trying to get rid of the fruit flies, right? And he grasped it. To the point where he then said, oh, we need it over here too. And that's another beautiful thing about the process of God inviting us on the journey to pray. As we're partnering with what God wants to do, sometimes it happens right away. We can see that, we talk about healings. I love to pray for healings. Got to pray for Clint the last time I preached too, and we saw the healing, boom, right there. Immediate healing. It was awesome, right? Sometimes we see it, but sometimes it's a journey, right? And sometimes it takes some time. We talk about just the vision and just the story of this, the life of this church, right? We know, God has confirmed and spoken to Pastor David and his family, right, in 1982 about what was going to happen, right? He came here and was pressing in, right? And we see the struggle. A lot of us have seen or been through the struggle and the issues, right? That revival is coming to Buffalo, that we're going to see this amazing move of God. And you hear it from prophetic people that are totally disconnected from literally around the globe, sending him, meeting him for the first time, and boom, they get the same exact thing over and over and over. And God is saying something, and we're pressing in, and we're praying. But sometimes we start looking on this level and we look around and we see the struggle. We see the hardship. We see the difficulty. We see, am I the only one the first time when Pastor David said that, when saying like, we're going to be part of a revival? Like revival, do you wonder, like a big move of God, like us? And doesn't that kind of, does anyone wrestle with that or struggle with that? Like, me? Why would I be involved with that? Why would I be there? Why would it be this church? Why there's a million? Well, why? Does anyone kind of struggle? That's that worldly thought process, right? That's that worldly thought process. But what the beauty of what God has done is this has been a long, painful, difficult journey. We've seen some amazing things along the road, but we haven't seen that yet, what we're going after, that vision that was put out. We haven't seen that yet. But here's the beauty, is we're partnering with God. God wants to do stuff, but you look through history, you look through Noah, you look through Moses, you look through David, you look through anyone in the Bible, God does his will and accomplishes it through mankind. He does his will through empowering mankind. How do we get empowered? We spend that time in prayer. And the beauty of this long, difficult journey that we've been on is it's driving us closer and closer to him. If we will allow it, we can use this process to get to know him more. And knowing God, wouldn't it just be him that we would learn the lessons along the way that would help sustain whatever he was going to give us down the road? Maybe we're learning what we need to learn now so that we can help lead the people that are coming. God wants to partner with us, and he wants to do it through prayer. But it takes us responding. It takes us stepping out. And the point I'm trying to make is that sometimes we're consumed with the journey instead of praying along the towards the destination. Right? Sometimes we're so distracted by what we see around, and it deters us from going and chasing towards that thing that God spoke out. But he's allowing us and inviting us into this journey with him. It's a beautiful, beautiful process that we're in right now. And I want to make sure that we're taking advantage of it. Oof. I'm going to have to fast forward. I'm like halfway through, but it's hot, and I'm not going to force you guys through that. I want to say this, too. Another beautiful thing through that process, as we're going through that process, is that we start to take ownership, right, that I mentioned with Luca. We take ownership of that journey. So I'm thinking that if we can change our perspective, like we can talk about prayer and saying the importance of prayer, but if we don't grasp the bigness or the reason why or the vision behind praying, prayer will just be a monotonous routine. It'll be a chore because we're not grasped. We're motivated because that's what our church leadership is saying right now. Okay, well, we'll do it. Okay, well, we'll sign up because that's what we're supposed to do, and I guess I'll pray. When I think of it, I'll do it, right? But if we grasp what's behind it, if we grasp the vision of what God's doing big picture, right, and then he invites us into this journey, then we can start not only getting to know him more, but we get to see the journey. We get to see the vision. We start taking responsibility and ownership for it. So that, what's that look like? In our marriages, right? It looks like our marriage. So I take responsibility for my mistakes in the marriage, but I also am the covering, and I want to take responsibility for my wife. So the mistakes that my wife makes or my shortcomings that she has that I have nothing to do with, I also repent for. I also take ownership of. I also take responsibility of, because I'm trying to go this direction, right? You're taking ownership of that process. And you can do that with the local churches, taking ownership of what's going on. I'm going to plug in. I'm going to find my spot on Nehemiah's wall, right? Nehemiah was rebuilding the wall, and each person had their own spot, their own task. So I'm going to take ownership of the bigger vision and do that through fulfilling my one role or my whatever that role is, right? What does it look like for a church to take ownership of a city? I'm talking about a church that takes responsibility and ownership for the city. That takes responsibility for rejuvenation. I know it's a big vision. I know it's out there. But to have influence, to send people into all aspects, all spheres of life, with business, with government, with education, wherever your job is at, whatever you do, to take responsibility for your city and say, I'm going to do my part. What happens when an entire church gets that vision and starts plugging in? Do we think that God's not going to bring more people in so he can plug more people in? Boom. What does it look like down the road? What does that big vision look like to have a church influence an entire city? I'm telling you, there's churches out there that are doing that, speaking the same language. Let's take ownership of our city. Not that we're dictating how things happen. No, how are we great, right? When Jesus corrected the disciples, when they wanted to be great, how are they great? He didn't say, don't be great. He said, this is how you're great. You serve. So what does it look like to take responsibility, take ownership in a city, and then begin to serve that city into the kingdom? If we can grasp this vision, the hard part sometimes is to think, well, how can I be a part of it? Why would God choose me to in this huge thing? The truth is, and it's been confirmed by person after person after person, everyone in this room, you have a role to play. You have a part. And we can keep talking about prayer, and it'll be a chore unless we grasp the bigger picture. And we all know, because we've prayed, sometimes those prayers where we really own it and go into it, it's because we possess that, we own that, we're taking responsibility, and we're interceding on behalf of it. What I want to do is try to cast that vision to you. And I can do it, but I'm flawed. But if the Holy Spirit does it, now we're on to something. Now we're on to something. You won't be able to keep people away. You won't be able to keep people praying and interceding because we'll see it. And the momentum's going to grow and grow and roll and roll and roll. Okay, I'm going to try to do this quick. I was going to go through the story of Ezekiel chapter 37, the dry bones. You guys know that story? All right, so I'm going to kind of glaze over quickly. We're not going to read it, and then we're just going to kind of close here in a little bit. But the story with Ezekiel, I thought, I'm bummed because I love history and I love bringing that in. I have tons of like historical stuff I want to share with you guys. But anyway, I'll just do it super quick because we don't really have time. Ezekiel, God sent judgment on Israel and sent them all across, right? He used the Babylonians to come in and spread them, right? They weren't honoring God, and so he used the Babylonians to spread them, and it happened in a couple waves, and one of the waves is Ezekiel, right? Ezekiel was part of the waves of Jews that were sent out, that were pulled out by the Babylonians, right? And so Ezekiel, then God gives Ezekiel this prophetic vision of what he wants to do to Israel, and the beautiful thing is that it also applies to us here today. So we're going to look at the very end that kind of does that. But he basically, the story is that God brings him in the spirit to this valley of dry bones. And he asks this question. He says, can these dry bones live? And in this question, we see that invitation. We see that, will you come? It's almost like this, do you think we could do this? Do you think this can happen? It's like this invitation into this miraculous thing that's going to happen, right? So he's inviting, through this question, he's inviting Ezekiel on this journey that we're talking about, right? He says, can these bones live, right? And long story short is God speaks to Ezekiel and says, pray that these dry bones would rise up. And the dry bones rise up. And he says, prophesy to these bones that there'll be tendons and ligaments, muscle and skin. And boom, he prophesies, and it happens. And we see this journey of God bringing separated, scattered, ununited things together, bringing them together, and then bringing life. And then he says, breathe life into them. And so we see this journey of God reviving, right? Then in verse, I think it's 11, which we're going to look at. Yeah, in verse 11, he says that this is the nation of Israel. This is my people, Israel. So what's he saying? He's saying, these people are scattered and not unified and all over the place. I'm going to speak to them. I'm going to bring them together, right? And then I'm going to unify them. And then I'm going to speak life into them. And they're going to come alive. It's a prophetic vision of what's going to happen. We see that come to pass with Ezra and Nehemiah. Like 2 years ago, we went through the Nehemiah project, right? And we broke that down. Boom, 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 with Nehemiah. Nehemiah is part of the answer and the fulfillment of this vision in Ezekiel. Nehemiah came and rebuilt the wall, and that was the natural rebuilding of the city. And how did he get that? Well, we'll get to that in a second. Ezra came 15 years earlier, and he was the spiritual revival in the city. He came and they found the old scriptures, the old scrolls, and he started reading them in the center of town. And people started repenting before the Lord and bowing down. This is after 70 years, right? They start repenting, right? So there's a spiritual revival. Nehemiah brings a natural revival. And we see a city renewed. Does anyone know the first step when God called Nehemiah? What happened? What was the first thing that happened with Nehemiah? Does anyone know? I know I'm putting you on the spot, but Nehemiah's in the king's court. He hears about Jerusalem, and what does he do? What happens? He starts weeping. He starts crying. He's in the king's court. He hears about the disheveled state of Jerusalem, and he starts weeping. And he's like, "That's my city. That's not okay. That's Jerusalem. That's not okay. We need to do something about this." You had somebody that was hungry, that grasped the vision. And then he prays. He cries out to God. God meets him. And we know throughout that journey with Sanballat and all the opposition that he received, he kept going back to prayer. He kept going back to God. He was scared for his life. He went back to God. We see this God partnering, or man partnering with God's purpose, God's vision, through prayer. At the end of that story, in verse 14, it says, actually 13, says, "Then you shall know that I am the Lord, when I have opened your graves. O my people, brought up from your graves, I will put my spirit in you, and you shall live. I will place you in your own land. Then you shall know that I, the Lord, have spoken it and performed it." Church, what does that sound like? That he opens the graves, right? That he opens the graves, and he puts his spirit in people, and then he gives them a promise, and he gives them land. What does that look like? Church, that's us. That we were dead in our trespasses and sin, that he's made us new creations, that he puts his spirit in us, and then he gives us our land. What's the land? It was the promised land for the Israelites. What's our promised land? It's the kingdom. It's the kingdom. It's not there and there. It's within us. That is our promised land. And then he brings us in as friends, and even more than that, sons and heirs. And he says, "Go out. Go out. This is who we are. This is who we are as Christians. I will not be a victim. I will not be thrown down by political upheaval or issues or persecution. I'm not on defense. I'm a Christian. The kingdom is advancing. I don't care if we miss people or people aren't going to the church or the percentage of a city. I mean, you understand, I do care about that, but that doesn't stop me. Come on. This is who we are. This is who we are. And this is our purpose. If we get this perspective with prayer, if we could grasp this vision, doesn't that change our whole perspective on prayer? We understand that battles are not in flesh and blood, but are fought in the spirit, right? Principalities, strongholds, powers of darkness, right? That's where our battles are. Man, we know it, but we've got to get it from here to walk it out. And I'm telling you, Home City Church is part of the tip of the spear. We're part of the tip of the spear, which means that all of you in this room, all of us, are leaders. All of us are leaders. We're going to be doing things that nobody else is doing. We're going to look different for a while. Studies show that if you get 10% of the people to be unified and buy in, that's all you need to start a movement. 10%. What if all the Christians stood up? It's far more than 10%. And we lived this. We have the opportunity to hear. We're leaders. We're forerunners, which means when nobody else sees it, when no one else even sees the momentum, we're the ones going out and going after it and keeping after it and praying and praying and praying and praying on our knees in secret that nobody will ever know about. But we're those people. We're those people. We're part of those people. Now here's, we'll close with this if you guys want to come up. We'll close with this. That I can talk, and we can talk, we can motivate, and we can be energized and all that. The reality is that if we go home tonight and get up tomorrow and go to work, and we've already forgotten what's been talked about, this was a waste of time. It doesn't matter. Truly, truly, I understand, as the person speaking to you, I understand how powerless I really am without God. But if the Holy Spirit can minister to you, if he can speak to you today, and we're going to pray, I'm going to get out of the way, and we're going to let the Holy Spirit come. If he can deposit a vision, if he can deposit that heart, if he can deposit that hunger for prayer, or whatever that looks like specifically, whatever he's designed for you, if you can receive that, if you can grasp that, then we're going to see the blaze. We're going to see the little fire spurting up and the brush starting on fire. And all of a sudden that one tree goes, and then boom, before you know it, you've got a massive wildfire. So I can talk it up and we can talk. We can all be on board today. But if we leave tomorrow, or we leave tonight and we start life tomorrow and we forgot it, we just wasted 45 minutes. So we're going to pray, because I don't want that. And I know we set a culture in this church where you don't want that. We don't want to just come and out of routine and come to church just for that. No, we want to come and be transformed. We want to come and encounter the presence of God, which transforms. So why don't you rise to your feet and we're going to pray. And normally we do a closing song and you guys can play it and sing it, but you guys don't sing, all right? You guys don't sing. Don't even put the words up on the screen. They're going to pray and they're going to usher in the presence of God through worship. He's already here, but they're going to worship. And what we're going to do is continue our heart disposition in a position of receiving. We want to receive from God. Whether it be a fiery passion, whether it be a person to pray for, whether it be a specific thing he puts on your heart, whether it be a bigger vision of what's going on, whether it be a heart and a passion for this church, whether it be people in this church who are going through situations, whatever that looks like, God's going to put it on your heart because we're going to pray. And he's going to answer. And he's going to put it on your heart, and we're going to pray here today. First, we're going to receive, and then we're going to pray. So whatever that looks like for you, for me, I like putting my arms up. It doesn't have to look like that, but you put yourself in a posture. It's really your heart that needs to receive right now. And your heart doesn't have arms, right? But put your heart in a disposition of receiving right now. That the Holy Spirit has an open door to flow through. And the beauty is everyone is probably going to get something different. You can't have unity without diversity. That's uniformity. That's everything's the same. That's not unity. Unity has to have diversity. So everyone's going to get something different. Everyone's going to get something that stirs their heart. And we're just going to pray that you receive that. And that it's deposited by the Holy Spirit. Not by me, because I'm forgotten tomorrow. But the Holy Spirit, he can deposit a seed deep enough. So Lord, we pray right now. God, we humbly come before you, understanding that you are God over all. That you are the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. God, we come before you thankful for the opportunity to even come before you, to even be in your presence, something not known by so many generations. But God, that you invite us into that. Lord God, I pray as we come into your presence right now, Holy Spirit, you would put on people's hearts right now visions, dreams. Lord, you would put on right now, so you would stir their hearts in specific things for specific areas. God, that you would stir hearts for people that are lost, for people maybe they know, they don't know. God, I pray that you would stir up ownership and responsibility for where God has placed you in this church, in your family, in this city. Holy Spirit, have your way right now. Come and have your way right now. Right now. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. Right now, I just want to rebuke the spirit of shame right now. If you feel like you're not good enough, you're not important enough, or you don't have a role, that the truth, right? Scripture says that we take every thought captive and put it under the authority of Christ, right? And that thought that you're not good enough, or you're not important enough, or that you're not able to follow through, or you're not able to do that, I rebuke that shame in Jesus' name right now. And we put that under the authority of Jesus Christ, which is that you are a son and a daughter of the living God, that you have a purpose, that he knew you before you were even born, that he knitted you in your mother's womb, that he knows the hairs on your head. I rebuke that spirit of shame in Jesus' name. That you are here for a purpose, not by accident. Holy Spirit, come and speak to us. We pray you dive that seed deep. I break off any chains, any things that are holding back of just overwhelming responsibility, any fear that's coming in because of this, we break that in Jesus' name. Any fear of doing it wrong or messing it up or stepping outside of God's will, I rebuke that in the name of Jesus. That the Holy Spirit is given to lead you into all knowledge and truth. And there is enough grace to cover a mistake that you did, that you thought God was doing. There's enough grace to cover you for that. Keep going after Him. Thank you, Lord. Just take a moment right now and just pray. Whatever God showed you, whatever He gave you, just pray. If you haven't received something and you've never done this before, never gone through this before, don't try to make something happen. This isn't, man, that's fake. We don't want that. Just stop trying. Just stop trying and wait. Just listen. Sometimes it comes as an image in your imagination or your mind's eye. Sometimes it comes as a word. Sometimes it comes as a thought. Sometimes it comes as someone's name or some place or a picture of something coming to mind. But you can't make this stuff happen. You can't force it to happen. Just receive. Just relax and just receive.
Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations.
Holy Spirit, come. Holy Spirit, come. Thank you for it. If you haven't been praying, just take a few moments as we wrap up here just to pray into whatever that was. It's going to look different for everyone, but just take a moment to pray and to partner with God in that thing. Lord, I thank you. I thank you for this morning. I thank you for this time together with you. I thank you for it. Lord, I bless these people as they go. Lord, I pray for open doors and open opportunities for them to test that will, for them to test what it is to hear from you. Lord, for them to step out in these different areas. I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord, for this time of waiting. I thank you, Lord, for this time of developing right now. That Moses waited 80 years, that Jesus waited 30 years, that David waited 14 years to see the fulfillment of the vision. God, I thank you for this time of development right now here for Home City Church. And we pray that your will be done, that we would see the fullness. We would see the fullness of what you have destined to happen in this city, in this church, in our lives, in our families, in our marriages. I thank you, Lord. Lord, we pray for the food that's in the back. God, we thank you for fellowship. We thank you for the awesome time to spend with each other. We ask that you would bless that food, make it healthy to our bodies, and bless our fellowship as we connect with one another, God. I pray as not just today, but as we go in the coming months, we will continue to step out in that community, to connect with one another. In Jesus' name, amen.